Hey, good morning and welcome everybody to this Thursday, February 29th, 2024 edition of Trading Places Live at earningsbeats.com. I'm Tom Bowley, Chief Market Strategist here, and I'll be with you for the next 30 minutes or so as we prepare for the next trading day. Last trading day of February, and it is a leap year. So we don't get February 29th very often. It's been 4 years, but welcome and overall, I think markets started off 2024 pretty well for the first couple months. Futures are jumping this morning a little bit. We did have the personal income and spending report out this morning. And of course, that has an inflation component in it that the Fed likes to keep an eye on, the PCE, personal consumption expenditure. There we go. It's like every once in a while, you just have those old moments. But anyway, the PCE was out this morning and all the readings, the PCE monthly, annual, year over year, the core, everything came in exactly as expected. And that reversed futures this morning. Earlier this morning, futures were down. I think maybe the small caps were flat, but the others were down. And now let me read you, or at least as of a couple minutes, they were doing really well a couple minutes ago. Diamonds right now up 0.25%, back over 390. The spider, the SPY, trading tracking the S&P 500, up about 0.33%, back up to 508. That's up $1.72 this morning. We've got the QQQ, which tracks the Nasdaq 100. That is up about 0.6%, getting close to 438 again. Then we've got the IWM, which is currently at 205.66. That's up $3.34, 1.65%. And that number on the IWM is pretty significant because we have not had a close over 205. So we are currently in pre-market at 205.66. So this is potentially breakout day for small caps, taking out a lot of different highs. And we'll talk about that in just a couple minutes. But anyway, it should be an interesting day, at least as we close out the month of February, get ready for March, which I've talked about historically, not a great month. We've seen Marches go higher. We've seen Marches go lower. Most recently, of course, March 2020 with the pandemic, that certainly skews some of the numbers a little bit. But even without that, March historically has not been a very good month of the year. So we got all that to look forward to, but for now, let's just take a look at what happened yesterday. So let's jump in to the action. We got the Dow Jones Industrial Average down yesterday, 23 points. That was less than 0.1%. S&P 500 down 8. That was down about 0.2%. NASDAQ was down 96 points, which was a little more than 0.5%. Mid caps completely flat. Russell 2000 down $1.68. That was down about 0.8%. And we had gotten up above 204. So the IWM had settled back yesterday, but with the just no bad news, I guess. No bad news is good news on the inflation front. That's what the market seems to be saying. But with that, the IWM today up more than $3 and back above that 205 area. Transports down 90 yesterday. That was down about almost 0.6%. So across the board, it wasn't very good action. Just everything we looked at other than mid caps, which were flat, everything else down yesterday. But that's been kind of typical here over this past week or so. We've just been kind of consolidating, a little bit of back and forth, seen a little bit of upside this week out of the small caps, but the others really have been mostly flat to maybe even down a little bit. Moving on to the sectors. Real estate jumping 1.25% yesterday. Discretionary up 0.4%. Financials up a little bit more than 0.3%. And it's been interesting because every day I get reminded of what's been leading as I go through and do the show. And I usually look at it first thing in the morning. Sometimes at the end of the day, I'll check to see exactly where everything finished. But when I do this in the morning, it kind of, you know, reminds me of what's leading and what's not. And if I look at the three groups leading today or yesterday, real estate, discretionary, and financials, they're all different than what we've seen throughout the week. I mean, we've seen utilities lead, we've seen technology lead, we've seen communication services lead, we've seen industrials have good days, and I don't know, just an energy. Energy was up there earlier in the week, and today it's real estate, discretionary, and finance. The money's just kind of just rotating. I mean, it's not really doing any, as the market pulls back a little bit here, the Nasdaq anyway, and S&P, as we pull back a little bit, there's been some rotation, but we're not seeing a mass exodus. We're not seeing a big drop down, and maybe that's going to come, but it's just been sideways action, which to me is pretty bullish. I mean, when you're as overbought as we are, and we have all the different things we've talked about that should lead the market to the downside, and we just kind of meander just a little bit lower. And the meanwhile, we got another asset class, small caps, literally on the verge of another, of a really big breakout this morning. That just tells me that this market may not be ready for much selling at all. And maybe we're just going to hang in here. You know, maybe we go down to 5,000 or just below. Maybe we move back up a little bit above that 5,100 level. Maybe we make a push for 5,200. But it just seems like right now we're just digesting all those gains. And barring some sort of a big inflation report, I mean, we'll have the CPI and the PPI out in another 10 days to 2 weeks. You know, barring some kind of a big number there, maybe the jobs report does something that I just don't know what's on the horizon right now. The market seems to just be dealing with whatever comes its way and just kind of, you know, shrugging it off. And like I said, just a little bit of this consolidation where leadership just continually rotating every day and the market not really doing much. But there's definitely is movement toward the small cap, and we want to keep an eye on that, especially today. Let me give you a quick update again. I'm really interested in watching this. It's now up over $4, the IWM, 206.35. It's going to be a big, 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 big day potentially for small caps. Looking down at the industry groups, you can see renewable energy. This is kind of a strange group leading yesterday too. Renewable energy, which has been trying to kind of regain strength, it's at least been holding the lows that were established back in November. Of course, when you look at what the S&P 500 has done since November, a group that's just simply holding on to its lows isn't exactly a very good performing group. And so renewable energy is just trying to keep its footing and trying to regain some strength. So it was nice to see a little bit of strength in that group. You got mortgage finance group. I mean, I can't even remember the last time I put this group in as one of the top three industry groups, but it's not been doing badly. I mean, went up, set a nice new high in December, cleared that again in January, been trying to hang on to some support in the mid nines, you know, 9.25 or so. Yesterday with the jump more than 2% back up to 9.75, still got about another 3 or 4% to get to the area of breakout, but you know, it's nice to see this rotation in some of these groups that were leading, paused for a little bit, now coming back to lead again. And then you've got hotel and lodging REITs. So this is in the real estate area. And this is a group threatening to break out. This has been the strongest area within the REITs over the course of the past year or two, at least based on recollection. As I think back, I just remember going through real estate industry groups on my relative strength industry group chart list. And I just remember all of them being down, 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 except for this one. Hotels and lodging REITs continue to perform well. Pull back right to the 50-day, PPO right back down to the center line, and now we're trying to break back out again here with now a strengthening PPO. So we've got that bullish momentum starting to return and the group making breakouts above that early January 2024 high. And the AD line here looks pretty good. And across all of our major indices, you can see that AD line just continuing to perform extremely well. It's telling me this market ain't done. Again, could we consolidate for a period of time? Sure. I just don't see it going down. Not much. I would say 5-6%, maybe the max. Couple percent, maybe. But I really think, especially once, if we can get through this period coming up next few weeks, get through March, start heading toward another pre-earnings run with the Fed possibly lowering rates, or at least more and more talk of it. You know, if these inflation reports keep coming out tame, I just don't see the market going down. I really don't. not with rates already low and threatening to go lower. Just don't see it. I don't see the fundamentals or the technicals lining up for any kind of a big move to the downside. 10-year Treasury yield update here. Well, right now, 4.26%. We still got that 4.20 level. That was the area right here where we went up, topped, went back down near the lows, and then came back up, looked like we were topping again, and then made the breakout with the latest or the last CPI report, that January CPI report that came out on February 13th. It was a Tuesday. That's what caused this big move to the upside. There's been no follow through. I mean, we went up over 430, and that's essentially what's held. And if we don't get some other inflationary data or something, maybe a really strong jobs report next week, maybe that would spook investors thinking, okay, maybe it's not over. But I'll tell you something. If we get good jobs numbers and those inflation numbers keep coming down, that's nirvana for stocks. Absolute nirvana. So do with it what you may, but again, this is why in a secular bull market, I stay long. I may manage risk a little bit, but I stay long. Do not want to argue with a secular bull market advance. Anybody who's been bearish for a year, year and a half, I mean, you know the feeling. I mean, I don't know. I'd be out of money, I guess, if I was still shorting, trying to short. It's been a pretty much straight up move in some areas of the market. We've got other areas like industrials now that have been outperforming. I saw an article this morning, and you know me, I don't really rely a whole lot on other things out there that I see. I like to do my own research. But there was a stat I saw this morning that said that 48% of components of the industrial sector, 48% of the industrial sector has, or in, that are in the S&P 500, not all industrial components, 48% of the industrials that are in the S&P 500 have made new all-time highs in 2024. I mean, we hear all this, oh, it's just, you know, these four stocks or these seven stocks, you know, Magnificent Seven. Yeah, that's why the market's going up. Well, that would certainly argue against that because I don't know too many industrials that are in the Mag 7. So if you have 48%, it was by far the highest percentage of all sectors out there in terms of its S&P 500 component stocks making new all-time highs this year. I found that to be, you know, pretty encouraging. Information technology was second, but industrials leading. Does that sound like a bad market ahead to you? 48% of the industrial components in the S&P 500 setting new all-time highs. Market looks ahead. What are those industrials seeing that a lot of the bears aren't? Follow the charts. The charts tell us the story. They're really the only one that matters. They don't lie. That's where the money's going. S&P 500. We did have a couple of economic reports. Let me get to that too. Jobless claims came in a little higher than expected, 215,000 versus 210. The personal income for January jumped 1%. Expectation was only 0.4%. So certainly there's still enough money out there to spend. Personal consumption expenditures or personal spending plus 0.2% as expected. And then as I was mentioning, PCI price index month over month expected to come in at 0.3% rise. It's exactly where it came in. The PC price index year over year expected to come in at 2.4%, came in at 2.4%. Core PCE price index month over month rose 0.4%, exactly as expected. And the core PCE price index year over year came in at 2.8%, which was exactly what was expected. So the market is breaking, well, not every area of the market's breaking out, but we are seeing futures up and potentially small caps breaking out just on news that wasn't bad. It's not that it's any better than expected. It just wasn't higher than expected. And we're getting a relief rally. Market, you know, looking to maybe break back out again across the board, but certainly again on the small cap index. Speaking of the indexes, though, let's take a look. S&P 500, still got the negative divergence. Not much is changing right now. But as we consolidate, this PPO will continue to move lower. If we break out, maybe we take out this prior, prior high on the PPO. And a lot of people say, well, yeah, but we still have to take this one out. You know, I'm getting to the point where I'm ignoring that one, because this was what, 2 months ago, over 2 months ago, more like 10 weeks ago. Think about the data that goes into these numbers or into the PPO. If you use a default PPO, it's a 12-day and 26-day. How far is 26 days go back? 5 weeks. I mean, I like to follow these negative divergences when the peaks on the PPO are within 5 weeks of one another. I think once you get beyond that, you're not even comparing the same data. You got two different data sets. So it's not like the first rate, you know, the PPO back here that was created by this run to the upside, none of that data is in the PPO now. So I really, and that's why I don't go back. Like, I mean, should we go back way back to here? This actually took it out a little bit, but let's just say that came in a little lower than this. Do we go all the way back to here? If this is the highest PPO on the chart, and every time the market advances, we just say it's a negative divergence because we never took that one out. I mean, it's ridiculous. What the heck does momentum today have to do with momentum back in June on a daily chart? Again, the data, it makes no sense to me. So this was a negative divergence, higher price, lower PPO. There's your reset. You know, back in August when we started the correction, you know, we don't know how far we're going to go down. We don't know when we have a negative divergence. Is it going to be eliminated? Is it going to fall back maybe to the center line? Is it starting, you know, maybe a correction where it goes down for a little bit longer? Is it starting a bear market like we had in 2022? We don't know. This only tells us it's slowing momentum. It doesn't tell us how bad things are going to get. So understand that the daily PPO is basically giving us a signal, maybe for the next 1 to 3 weeks. That's when I look at these negative divergences, that's what I'm thinking in my head. 1 to 3 weeks, 5 to 15 days, basically is what I look for these negative divergences to play out. And if we do go higher and we break out again and that PPO turns up and takes out that high, at that point, I'm going to be thinking, you know, bullish momentum, no negative divergence. NASDAQ 100. Very similar looking chart, breakout, still got that lower PPO. Here's one. Here the PPO is much higher back in June. So was this high right here? Was this a negative divergence? Prices were higher than they were back here. PPO is lower. By definition, that's a negative divergence. Why don't people talk about that as a negative divergence? I mean, if all you're going to do is just compare lines on the chart, you know, you got to use a little common sense. And so these play out. I mean, after the correction, why are we looking at daily momentum versus the daily momentum back before correction even started? I mean, right? I mean, am I wrong? Post something. I mean, if you disagree with me, post it in the comments. But, you know, I try to always, you know, look at technical analysis and just throw common sense in. You know, instead of just looking at lines on the chart, that's what a lot of technicians do. Well, this line's below this line, and half the time they don't even know what the line means. But because this line's below that one, they've been taught by the book that this is what's going to happen. And again, this is a secondary indicator, PPO. All right, IWM. Why is this such a big deal this morning on the IWM? Well, let me show you why. I'm going to go back 5 years. I'll go back 5 years first just to show you the long-term resistance and support. So you can kind of see right there around this 160 level. And I've talked about this before. Right before the pandemic, that was the high. We went back down. And I think there was another high over here around 160, I believe. Anyway, we broke out. We've gone back down. Look where we've gone to. And people wonder why I follow technical analysis. It's like broken price resistance becomes price support. That's a poster child. There was the resistance. We broke out and then we come back down multiple occasions right to 160 and we hold. Now, I can show it to you on this chart, but probably on the shorter term chart would show up even better. But first of all, look at these triple peaks right here. That was at about 197, 198. That's where that came in. When we first went down to start this cyclical bear market in 2022, where was the reaction high? I mean, we really started to break down in January. That's where we took out a lot of support area over here, and we ended up bouncing back. Where was that reaction high? It was right at about 205, 206. So today, with this gap up, we easily have cleared this triple. We already did that once. Went back, hit the 50-day moving average, and now coming back up. And the latest, let's just keep looking. It is right now at, well, back to 205.47. So it's up 315. Let's see where it opens. Opens and closes are what are important to me. If this opens under 205, and then we get a false breakout, and then we go back down, short-term, that is a short-term failure of a breakout. A breakout and a failed breakout are two different animals. Breakout's bullish. Failed breakout, I'm not going to say it's bearish, but it's just short-term cautious, because you don't like to get that breakout intraday and then fail to sustain it into the close. So market makers can figure out where they want to be at the close in terms of all their open positions. And so I always pay attention to that closing bell. Where do we close? Intraday, it could be an opportunity where market makers are trying to get, trying to distribute shares. And they know when a price breaks out, they're going to have plenty of buyers out there, and they can distribute shares during the day, during that breakout. It's much easier. You can get a lot more shares that you can distribute when there's a breakout. Why? Because you have a lot more technical buyers. People buy on breakouts. And sometimes, unfortunately, they end up buying on failed breakouts. And that's where you have to be careful in the short term. So today's going to be a big day for the IWM. I was getting really excited when I saw 206, but now back to 205. I'll calm my excitement a little bit, but I still think this could potentially be a really, really good day for the IWM. We'll see. Transports. Let's get out of there. Transports, you can see just sideways consolidating. Not really a whole lot to say. Most of the selling yesterday was at the opening bell. We had the gap down, and we had some volatility intraday, to the upside and to the downside, and ended up closing almost right where we opened. So not a whole lot going on there. Moving on, chart of the day. Just wanted to tell you, if you're not familiar with earnings beats, maybe this is your first time here. A couple things if you want to learn more about how we approach the market. First, go over to earningsbeats.com, scroll down. You've got name, email address, and subscribe. This is for our free newsletter, the Earnings Beats Digest. No credit card required. You can unsubscribe at any time. This is simply me giving away my time, looking at charts, and showing you some of the things that are important to me and to us at Earnings Beats. And, you know, you can use it. You can maybe gain some technical knowledge, technical analysis knowledge. Maybe it helps you in your trading. But really the purpose for me is just providing some value to our community out there. We like to educate. That's one of our key pillars. If you look up here, research, education, guidance. That's what we're all about. And we do a lot of research and we do a lot of educating. And so this is just one piece. This is one free piece of our education process. So make sure if you haven't already, sign up for the EB Digest. Tens of thousands of folks have subscribed to this. If you want to try our service, our paid service, you will have to give credit card, but it's still a 30-day free trial. And we will remind you before your 30 days expires that you are coming up for a renewal. So there's no big surprise. You don't just look at credit card and say, oh, I forgot about it. Nope, we're going to remind you. We don't want you to pay for our service if you don't want to be a member of Earnings Beats. So anyway, check that out. We'd love to have you. So today, what I thought I would do is I wanted to look at, rather than looking at a chart, I thought what I would do is pull up, you know, we just talked about the industrials. So I thought maybe what we could do is look at the sector summary. And there's your industrial. So yesterday, industrials did pretty well. I'm just kind of focusing on industrials after reading that 48% comment, that 48% of the industrials in the S&P 500 have set new all-time highs in 2024. I just thought, okay, maybe I want to look at that group a little bit more. So that was intraday. Over the last week, industrials sitting very close to the top of the leaderboard. Over the last month, industrial second, only to consumer discretionary, leading the market to the upside. 3 months, industrials in the number two spot. Again, and look at the last 3 months, financials, industrials, healthcare, communication services. Well, financials, industrials, and healthcare. When I rank my sectors 1 through 11 in terms of aggressive to defensive, actually it should be 1 through 9, because materials and energy, I don't rank as aggressive or defensive. I don't really think they're either. I consider them like neutral. They can go up in any market. They can go down in any market. I don't really see the correlation. Sometimes, you know, back in the, was it 2003 to 2007 or 2006 bull market, energy led that to the upside. But we've seen other bull markets where energy, recent bull market, where energy has lagged horribly. So it doesn't really matter what the overall market's doing. Energy and materials kind of do their own thing. But if I was going to rank them 1 through 11, I would start technology, consumer discretionary, communication services, industrials, financials, healthcare. That would be my top six. So we already saw communication services, technology, and consumer discretionary. They've been leading this secular bull market since 2013. They are way ahead of every other sector since 2013. But over the last 3 months, look at the rotation. This is bullish rotation. The market keeps going higher. And everybody, you know, still got a lot of folks saying, no, it's the Mag 7. It's the Mag. Really? Because I'm looking at the last 3 months and I'm seeing financials, industrials, and healthcare leading to the upside. And last time I checked, there's not a lot of representation, those three groups in the Mag 7. I mean, not a lot of representation, those three groups in the NASDAQ 100. Not like these other three down here. So you tell me, has this bull market branched out? Are we seeing more companies, more areas of the market benefit? All I hear is, well, it's more narrow. It's more narrow. It's been more narrow because small caps are not performing. There's a lot of small caps. Russell 2000. The Russell Index has 3,000 companies in it. 2,000 make up the small cap index. When small caps aren't performing, you are not going to get great breadth. You're just not. I mean, if you're looking at new highs and new lows, you're not going to get great breadth because the majority of the companies are not in that large cap tier. The majority of the companies are in tiers that have not been participating, which is why I get excited when I see small caps getting ready to break out. I listen to all these stories, I see the headlines, and it makes me sick because everybody is reading this and everybody's reading all these experts talking about the market. And quite honestly, I think they put out a lot of really, really awful information to investors. Just my opinion. But yeah, take a look at that. Last 3 months. That's essentially that's not all the way back into late October, but that's late November. Late November to late February is 3 months. So we're talking about the majority of this move to the upside, or at least a good portion of it, has been led by three areas not named: technology, consumer discretionary, and communication services. So you be the judge. I say we're going higher. All right, it is 9:30, and that is essentially what I wanted to talk about today. This is the last show of the week, so won't be back until Tuesday. But I'll be back to members, with our daily market report later today. I'll be updating chart lists again between today and tomorrow. I'll try and get all those chart lists updated so all of members have fresh information as we go into next week and into a new month tomorrow. Probably won't have the chart list out until later. Anyway, that's it for me. Let's see what's going on in the market, see where we're opening. Are we seeing a breakout? Dow Industrials up 0.2%. S&P 500 back up almost to 5,100, up 0.45%, so almost a half of 1%. The NASDAQ 100 gapping back up near 18,000, actually just over it, up 0.75%. And then the big one, drum roll, we are over 205, 205.34 on the open. We opened at 205.18 Let's take a look and see. Here we opened at 20, or we closed at 204.82. So the open today is clearing everything in the last year. Let's go back 3 years. So right here, that was 206.03. So I've been saying 205. I guess technically it's 206.03. So I'm going to have to be a little more cautious with my comments. I was so excited. 206.03 is the actual number. So are we going to go through it today? The open didn't quite get there, but we are on the verge. And like I said, if this breaks out and we start moving up with small caps, all of a sudden, a lot of those new high numbers are going to start picking up. You're going to see a lot more small cap companies setting new 52-week highs. And then what are the bears going to talk about? Oh, we got the Hindenburg Omen. We got the Poseidon Adventure. We got all these things we can still talk about. I'm sorry. I do laugh sometimes because literally it's been one reason after another why this bull market's not going to continue. And the bull market just keeps going. Anyway, that's it for me, everybody. Have a great rest of your day, rest of your weekend, and happy trading.